Good morning. What a joy to be worshiping with you here at 10th after a 39-year absence. I attended 10th when I was a Westminster Seminary student in the 1980s. I was newly married, and my wife and I continue to think that our small group in Fort Washington set the gold standard for small groups. So thank you, Eric and Jill Hosvet, for your hospitality. I still remember Dr. Boyce preaching his way through Genesis, week after week. In fact, I don't recall him preaching about anything else. So, I am pleased to learn that four decades later, you've made it to the book of Revelation. And although I've been away, I've maintained unofficial connections to 10th. I served under your former pastor, Phil Ryken, when I was a professor at Wheaton. And just last year, I had the pleasure of teaching Gavin at one of my Trinity courses via Zoom. It's especially a pleasure to be with you on this Father's Day. Christians have every reason to celebrate fathers and their important vocation to represent the fatherhood of God. What a privilege and responsibility. The Scottish author George MacDonald once said that fatherhood is the principle that runs the universe. Our secular age has lost sight of that. The prevailing assumption is that our universe runs on impersonal, mechanical principles. Not so. Jesus tells us that no sparrow falls to the ground apart from our Heavenly Father. Fatherly care is at the core of the universe. In fact, C.S. Lewis says that the love of God the Father for God the Son is earlier than the universe. It's been going on before there was a universe. So let's not forget that deep theological truth this Father's Day. And speaking of the calendar, according to the church calendar, we're in ordinary time, that period of the Christian year where instead of celebrating the events of Jesus' birth and life and death and resurrection, we focus on discipleship. Daily growth in the Christian life, becoming mature in Christ. And this morning's service concludes our weekend conference on what it means to be a disciple in the 21st century. Now, I know Dr. Gallagher has been preaching for the past few weeks on the book of Revelation. You've been studying apocalyptic literature, which is all about the importance of persevering in our Christian witness despite persecution. And we do so in the certain hope that all will be well, thanks to the Father's love and the loving obedience of His Son, our King who has conquered death and the devil. The passage this morning fits this overall series very nicely, even if it comes from the Gospels instead of the book of Revelation. Appropriately enough, Mark 13, sometimes called the Olivet Discourse, is also known as Jesus' little apocalypse. So like the book of Revelation, this little apocalypse is about the end of the world. The chapter begins with Jesus predicting the destruction of the Jerusalem temple and his own eventual return. But we're not there yet. And so in the middle of chapter 13, Jesus warns his disciples not to think that the end has come prematurely. Battles and earthquakes and such are but the beginning of the birth pains, he says, the labor that has to take place for there to be a new creation. But as I say, we're not there yet. So Jesus goes on in Mark 13 to encourage his disciples to preach the gospel and bear witness to the coming kingdom of God in the meantime, even if it means persecution, because the Holy Spirit has been given us to empower our witness. So you see, though it's about the end time, apocalyptic is really written for people in the present. Apocalypse now. I think I heard that somewhere. It's all about discipleship enduring now until the end. And because we don't know when the end will be, we have to stay on our toes. And that's the gist of this morning's passage, Mark 13, verses 32 to 37. It's the last paragraph of Jesus' little apocalypse. So let's read it now. But concerning that day or that hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard, keep awake, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to stay awake. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight, or when the rooster crows, or in the morning. Stay awake, lest he come suddenly and find you asleep. And what I say to you, I say to all, stay awake. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Jesus' words are as important and as radical for us today as they were for the first disciples. It's so easy to go through the days and years dreaming with our eyes wide open, asleep at the wheel of our own life story. But Jesus here issues an existential wake-up call, a demand to become alert and attentive to the real world, not the world of stock markets or stockpiles of nuclear weapons, the real world to which God's word has come through the prophets, the real world where God is at work bringing all things together in Christ. But staying awake is hard. It's a truth, universally acknowledged, that a college student home on summer vacation must be in want of a nap to sleep, hopefully through the night. Birds do it, bees do it, beluga whales even do it. American men and women, not so much. We're sleep deprived, wired in workaholics. 40% of us are getting less than 6 hours of shut-eye per night. Contrast that with what was going on in 1910, when people slept an average of 9 hours a night. Imagine. No wonder, then, that the quest for a good night's sleep has become a cultural obsession and big business. Consumers spent more than $40 billion on sleep-related products in 2015 alone. So what exactly is Jesus asking disciples to do? The first thing to note is that we're all somebody's disciples. The question we have to ask ourselves is whose words, whose advice, whose wisdom are we following? For example, whose ideas about love inform your understanding of what love is? There's so many claims out there. Love means never having to say you're sorry. The film Love Story. Or all you need is love, say the Beatles. And Justin Bieber, he has an even more pithy saying, love yourself. But maybe you want to get your notion about love from a more respectable source, like Albert Einstein, who says, you can't blame gravity for falling in love. Or maybe you're a cultural elite who likes literature and you read James Joyce, who says, love loves to love love. So there are many ways to be a loving person, but to be a follower of Jesus, you have to hear and do what he says. And he had some things to say about love. He taught his disciples the great commandment to love God with all their hearts and minds and soul and strength and their neighbors as themselves. That's the cost of discipleship, to cite the title of Dietrich Bonhoeffer's classic book. So if you want to know whose disciple you are, look at the way you think about and express and practice love. You see, to be a disciple is to commit to living a certain way. And way is the first name for Christians in the early church. In Acts 9, we read of those who belonged to the way. Being a Christian is not so much about being a good person, because Jesus' way isn't simply the way of morality. Rather, being a Christian is all about living out the life of Christ in us through faith by His Spirit. And when we make and when we walk the Christian way, we make what mattered most to Jesus matter most to us. That's what it means to follow Jesus' way. We make what mattered most to Him matter most to us. And what mattered to Jesus was seeking first the kingdom of God. The kingdom isn't simply one item on the disciples' to-do list. It's rather the one thing that puts everything else into its proper place. To seek the kingdom of God is to let Christ, our King, rule over everything we happen to be doing. So, in light of our insomniac times, how should disciples understand and follow Jesus' command in verse 33? Be on guard, stay awake. Again, the immediate context is his teaching about the coming day of the Lord. In verse 32, he says, about that day or hour, no one knows. And it's precisely because we don't know when Jesus will return to usher in the final phase of the kingdom of God that we have to stay alert. Now, at this point, because I'm a guest and a theologian, I hope you'll let me introduce a theological term, a technical one. It's eschatology, the study of last things. Eschatos, meaning last. You've probably heard people discussing end times, the end of the world. It's a very popular genre among young people these days, dystopian fiction. There are books and television shows and films about the end of the world. And some Christians are trying to figure out when Jesus will come back. Well, we've been there, done that countless times, and it typically ends with an embarrassed excuse for getting the date wrong and then a recalculation. But I think Jesus' point is we need, as disciples, to be ready whenever. And as I say, Christians are not the only ones with an eschatology. There are lots of people worried about the end of the world. I recently saw a roadside billboard near my home in Illinois advertising a survivalist expo. And I was so interested, I stopped the car and wrote down the caption. And here's what I wrote. This is on a big billboard. If you have thought about what it means to prepare for the worst, the Chicagoland Survival Expo is for you. Long-term food storage, tactical gear, and so much more will be available for purchase. Do you think that's what Jesus had in mind? Stockpiling supplies, weapons, building underground bunkers? No, the way of Jesus is not the way of doomsday prepping. Disciples should be people who prep for the day of the Lord, and it's anything but doom, at least for disciples. So it's important to remember that eschatology, this preoccupation with last things, it begins now. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. But we, disciples, are living between the times, between Jesus' resurrection and His second coming, in time. We're between the times. And that's why Jesus' charge to stay alert is a call to eschatological discipleship, knowing how to follow Jesus between the times, ready for the end. So we live in our present time between Jesus' first and second comings. Ours is not to reason when, ours is but to watch and tend. Well, Jesus tells a story now in Mark that illustrates eschatological discipleship, what it looks like to live between the times of his first and second coming. In verses 34 to 36, it's a little parable, and it's unique to Mark's gospel. It's a tale about the need for watchfulness in the master's absence. But before we look at the story, let me address a question you may be asking yourself. How literally are we to take Jesus' words? Because on a surface reading, the cost of discipleship seems to be never getting a good night's sleep. Well, we need to take Jesus' teaching with the utmost seriousness, but this doesn't mean having to read it literalistically. Because elsewhere in the New Testament, sleep is a metaphor for spiritual dullness or inattention. For example, in 1 Thessalonians 5:5, Paul describes disciples as children of light, children of the day. And then he says, "So let us not sleep as others do, but let us, disciples, keep awake and be sober." So the fact is, as I mentioned, the science tells us, everyone needs a good night's sleep in order to be alert during the day. Now, don't take my word for it. Read the New York Times bestseller, Why We Sleep, by the director of the Center for Human Sleep Science at UC Berkeley. If in that book we learn that the biological drive to sleep is found throughout the animal kingdom, but that humanity is the only species on the planet that deliberately deprives itself of sleep. So much so that the World Health Organization has declared a sleep loss epidemic in industrialized nations. Now, scientists have stayed awake overtime trying to figure out why we need sleep. We can't gather food, we can't make money, we can't find a mate when we're asleep. So it used to be thought that sleep was a kind of biological appendix. We just didn't understand its function. New research has shown that sleep enhances every organ in the body and that it may be the most effective thing we can do to rest our brain and body each day. So all this to say that Jesus is not literally telling us not to sleep. In God's wisdom, sleep is part of the created order, and it was very good. It's not an evil. So Jesus is speaking here metaphorically about staying alert to the coming kingdom of God. And in his story, he compares himself to the man going on a journey, because he will soon be leaving his disciples. They see him leave. They see him ascend into heaven. But just before he leaves, he promises them to send the Holy Spirit to empower their witness to the ends of the earth. And of course, he promises to come back. But in the meantime, disciples should be busy with their assigned tasks. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come. Now, the house the servants are to look after is most probably the church. The New Testament often speaks of the church as a house or a household of God. Look at Ephesians 2:19, for example. And so by the end of the passage, we see that Jesus is addressing the whole church, not just the church leaders, but all disciples. The point of this short parable, then, is all about the importance of remaining vigilant, alert, attentive to the coming kingdom of God. When I went to Scotland to teach at the University of Edinburgh, I was told that one of my responsibilities was to invigilate. That was a problem because I didn't know what it meant. It turns out it's the technical term for supervising students who are writing their final exams. Invigilate, remaining vigilant over the students and making sure there was no theft of intellectual property or cheating. Well, in this parable, I think Jesus is asking disciples to invigilate their own lives, to keep watch over the way they live. And in Mark 35, verse 35, he makes a special point of mentioning all four watches of the Roman night. In the evening, is 6 to 9 p.m., midnight, 9 to 12, when the rooster crows, 12 to 3 a.m., and in the morning, 3 to 6 a.m. In other words, disciples must stay awake in every segment of the night in order to keep watch. Now, being or staying woke has become a controversial notion in our times. Being woke means being aware of or active in matters pertaining to social injustice, especially racism. The Oxford English Dictionary now includes woke in its volume, so I guess it's official. I don't want to get into politics here, but I do want to say this. Long before it became a current term in our culture, Jesus was calling his disciples to stay woke, alert and attentive to the politics of the kingdom of God. Now, Mark has his own term for being woke in this more radical sense. It's a Greek word that means stay awake, and he uses it three times, so we know it's important. Verses 34, 35, 37, we read stay awake. The Greek term is gregoreo, gregoreo. It was a common term in the time, but Jesus gives it a new spiritual sense and a note of urgency. Did you know that the name Gregory comes from this Greek verb, to stay awake, gregoreo? You can hear how they sound similar. And that's also why there are so many Saint Gregories and even a couple popes named Gregory. The name Gregory reminds us that a true disciple is one who stays awake, spiritually woke, woke to the coming kingdom of God. In any case, this short parable of Jesus is a lesson about the importance of remaining alert. As I've already said, our whole lifetime will be lived between the first and second comings of Jesus. And so this parable reminds us that every day is for us a potential time of trial that is filled with opportunities to prove ourselves faithful, woke followers of Jesus. Or, God forbid, unfaithful followers. You see, the cost of drowsy discipleship, of failing to keep watch over our own spiritual lives, is spelled out in verse 36, when Jesus warns them, lest he come suddenly, lest the master of the house come suddenly and find you asleep. I'm sure you've heard the expression to fall asleep on the job. Some workplaces find that offense to be serious enough to merit being fired, termination of employment. I know that in Japan there's a tradition of napping at work without suffering that fate, but elsewhere it is a dangerous prospect. In 2008, two pilots fell asleep on their way from Honolulu to Hilo, Hawaii. They woke too late. They had to turn around. They had gone 15 miles past their destination. Happily, they had enough fuel that day. So staying awake on the job or at the controls is or can be a matter of life or death. But the ultimate cost of drowsy discipleship is not losing your job or even your life. The ultimate cost of drowsy discipleship is not getting to hear Jesus say at the end of your life, well done, good and faithful servant. Now, Jesus' disciples had an opportunity to practice what Jesus preached in the very next chapter, Mark chapter 14, because in this chapter we read that Jesus asks his three closest disciples to accompany him to Gethsemane, to keep watch while he, Jesus, prayed. Because Jesus was fast approaching his hour, the time where he would be tempted and tried, the hour of his decision to carry through with his mission and die for the sins of the world. And he wanted his close disciples with him. Do you remember what happens in Mark 14? We haven't read it. What happens is Jesus goes off to pray, he bears his soul to God, and he comes back and discovers the disciples sleeping. He goes off to pray a second time, And Mark says, when he returned, he found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy. Jesus prays a third time, comes back to the disciples, and yet again, they're sleeping. The three disciples that he had asked, Peter, James, and John, not a great support group. We're there for you, Jesus. Not so much. There's deep irony here, but I think Mark knows exactly what he's doing. Because in between Jesus' teaching about the importance of staying awake and this story of the disciples' failure to stay awake, Mark inserts the story of Jesus telling Peter that he would betray him three times before the rooster crows twice. In other words, Mark is showing us that Peter's hour of testing, his trial as a disciple, is going to come when he least expects it. Because that's after Jesus finishes praying in the garden, he gets arrested. And then a servant girl, a little while after that, accuses Peter of being one of Jesus' followers. And Peter denies it, insisting, "I do not know this man of whom you speak." This was Peter's big scene as a disciple. It was his moment of truth. It was his hour of decision, and he slept through it. Incredibly enough, earlier that same night, you see, Jesus had found Peter asleep when Jesus was preaching, and Jesus had told him, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation." Mark 14:38. So how can we resist temptation? How can we be disciples that avoid Peter's mistake? It's not simply through willpower. It's by remembering Jesus' words, by watching, and by praying. Or more to the point, it's by watching by praying. Praying is the best way to attend to God and to stay awake to all things pertaining to God. Parenthetically, I think the story that we've just been looking at about the disciples falling asleep and betraying Jesus, I think this story provides powerful evidence for the authenticity of the New Testament documents. Because you'd expect people who wrote the Gospels, the leaders of the early church, to portray themselves in a more positive light. But in strikingly honest fashion, they instead depict themselves in very unflattering terms. They admit that they fell asleep on the watch, that they failed too often to follow Jesus' words. That impresses me, that honesty. But it does make me ask the question, am I any more awake than those disciples? So let's return to Jesus' story about the absent householder, because here's how it concludes in verse 37. Jesus says, "What I say to you," that original group of disciples, "I say to everyone, stay awake." Well, everyone includes us. So what lessons can we take away from Jesus' little story in this little apocalypse? The first lesson, I think, is this. True discipleship is about waking up and staying awake to the reality of what God is doing in Christ to renew creation, to put the world to right, and to bring in his kingdom. True discipleship is staying awake to the coming kingdom of God. But there's a second truth or lesson that is not as positive, and it's this. Many of us today are only half awake. We may think we're engaged with the real world, but we're actually living in what C.S. Lewis calls the shadowlands. Listen to this letter that C.S. Lewis wrote in 1963, just a few months before his death, to a patient in a hospital that he knew was afraid to death of death. And here's what he wrote to her. He says, "Think of yourself as a seed, patiently waiting in the earth, waiting to come up as a flower in the gardener's good time, waiting to come up and blossom into the real world, the real waking. I suppose that our whole present life, looked back on from there, will seem only a drowsy half-waking. We are here in the land of dreams, but the cock crow is coming. And by the way, this is a good cock crow, right? This is the cock crow that the kingdom is coming, Christ is coming back, not the one that announces the fact that we've betrayed Christ. But if you heard this quote rightly, Lewis is saying that most of us are only half awake to the kingdom of God that is dawning in our midst. Maybe we're plugged into social media, following celebrity Twitter accounts or Instagram, more than we are to the gospel accounts of Jesus' life. If that's our problem, and I think in many churches it is, then we're suffering from what I like to call TADD, theological attention deficit disorder. The failure to pay attention to God and to all things as they relate to God. It's well documented that attention spans have shrunk in our time, thanks largely to electronic devices. The media studies guru Marshall McLuhan says that new technologies have a numbing, even narcotic effect that lulls attention. And in his book, The Shallows, Nicholas Carr says the internet is by design an interruption system, a machine geared for dividing attention. He says the net seizes our attention only to scatter it. What do you call a pedestrian who slowly shuffles along without being aware of his surroundings because he's talking on a smartphone? I'm sure you've seen them. Well, the term is smombi, a smartphone zombie. It's a real word. Smartphone overuse has reached epidemic proportions. Smombi apocalypse, anyone? Well, I hesitate to mention zombies from the pulpit, but it's important that Christians understand what is going on in our culture and what it means. Also, the letter to the church at Sardis in Revelation 3 mentions zombies. Not the term, but the concept. Listen, chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. You have the reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up. So, if a horror is a violation of God's good created order, then zombies, the living dead, fit the bill. Horrors. It violates the most basic distinction of the created order. You're either living or dead. The living dead is a horror. Did you know, by the way, that the first zombie film, George Romero's 1968 Night of the Living Dead, about a group of people trapped in a rural farmhouse, was filmed and set in Butler County, Pennsylvania? I'm just saying. But I'm mentioning zombies from the pulpit because they're the opposite of what Jesus wants his disciples to be. They're the prime examples of sleepwalking discipleship. And it's not even easy to say what a zombie is following. Some say zombies are symbols of mindless consumerism. There's kind of a prophetic word from secular society about what's wrong with our society. We're like zombies. We consume things mindlessly. And mindless is the operative term because the zombie is sort of alive, but they lack mindfulness. Someone has said, to be a zombie is to be oblivious to being oblivious. In any case, the cost of sleepwalking discipleship is that you inadvertently join the ranks of the living dead, dead in your sins, dead rather than alive to Christ. And one film historian says that the really horrifying thing about zombie films is that the monsters in question are not creatures from outer space or victims of radioactivity. No, the horrifying thing about these films is the monsters are us. That's what the film critic says. The zombies, they're us. So choose you this day whom you want to be, a member of the living dead or a wide awake disciple, a zombie or a Gregory. Our text concludes in verse 37 with Jesus' two-word urgent command, stay awake. And again, as we've seen, he's talking about being spiritually alert, alive to our discipleship, our life in Christ. In light of Jesus' command, we might even say that waking up and staying awake, awake to the reality of Christ in us and we in Christ, this is the essence of discipleship. And if that's so, how much greater the failure of those three disciples who couldn't do the one thing that Jesus asked, stay awake. So, friends, let me suggest that the Christian life is all about waking up to the reality that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Being Christianly woke means being attentive and attuned, not to ideologies about how we might achieve success, not about consumerism, but it means waking up to who we are in Christ. And only faith in God's word lets us see reality as it truly is. So we need to ask ourselves soberly and seriously, have we fallen asleep to reality, the reality of Jesus Christ? Have we let in cleverly devised myths? We need to ask ourselves, are we keeping watch over the doorway, not only to the house of the church, but the doorway to our own souls? So, the choices we make each day and each hour about what we let in to our minds and hearts, these choices reveal what we truly believe and whose side we're truly on. Jesus says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And there it is. Friends of Jesus do what he says. His friends are his true disciples, and his true friends stay awake. This is the disciples' responsibility, then, to stay spiritually awake for as long as possible. But how? Even a five-hour energy drink wasn't enough for me to keep me awake when I was driving 1 hour to Wheaton College on my commute. We've already said that physically, it all begins with a good night's sleep. But spiritual wakefulness is different. The Apostle Paul has not an energy drink, but a prescription for us. He says, pray continually. 1 Thessalonians 5:17. Pray continually. That's the way we keep watch. Because to pray is to speak to God. To speak to God is to be aware of God and attentive to his presence and activity. To pray, as we did this morning, is to remember that we should be seeking first the kingdom of God. True prayer isn't about asking God to do my will. True prayer is about God's will being done here on earth. Prayer, I suggest, is the antidote to what I called theological attention deficit disorder. Albert Camus, the French existentialist writer, was not a Christian, but as many others, he did have an eschatology, a theory about end time. In his novel, The Fall, one of the characters says, "You don't have to wait for the last judgment. It takes place every day." And I think the Gospel of Mark agrees with Camus, at least to this extent. We don't know the hour of Jesus' return, so we have to be ready for it. We don't want to be caught sleeping. So let's learn from Peter's bad example. Every moment has the potential to be our hour of trial, the last judgment, the hour of decision, that test to see if we're going to be awake to Jesus' lordship or sleep-wake-walk our way through life. Jesus was ready for his hour in Gethsemane. Peter was not. What about us? So the words disciples should be following are simply these. Be alert everywhere and at all times for that hour that tests and hopefully proves our discipleship. Because every occasion, whether we're eating or drinking, working or playing, every occasion gives us an opportunity to show that we're woke to the life of Christ in us. But here, as always, C.S. Lewis makes the point much better than I can. So hope you'll permit me another quote. Lewis says, "Happy are those whom the Lord finds laboring in their vocation, whether they're merely going out to feed the pig or laying good plans to deliver humanity 100 years hence from some great evil. Perhaps the curtain will fall. Those pigs will never, in fact, be fed. The great campaign against slavery or governmental tyranny will never, in fact, proceed to victory. No matter. You were at your post when the inspection came. You were at your post when the inspection came." Friends, the church exists to make disciples, people who are wide awake to the new reality in Christ that is dawning, people who are watching and waiting for every opportunity to bear witness to who their Lord is. Men and women who are ready for their hour of testing. Can I get a witness? Can Jesus get a Gregory? Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come. Let's pray. O Lord, awaken us. Open our eyes to the marvelous new life that is ours already in Christ. And pour out on us your Spirit so that we can live out the life of Christ in us. Help your church to stay alert to the deceptive ways of the world that lead to death instead of life. And grant to each of us, we pray, the strength to bear faithful witness to the way, truth, and life of Jesus in our hour of testing, in every hour. Help us to endure to the end as faithful witnesses. Through the strong name of our Lord and Savior, even Jesus Christ. Amen.